Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this morning's WAMinar. And our WAMinar this morning is called Understanding Dyspraxia, Developmental Coordination Disorders. So my name is Deirdre Moore, and I'm the WAM coordinator here at AHEAD. Thank you for joining us today. A big welcome back to those of you who have already joined a WAMinar in the past, and a warm welcome to anybody joining us for the first time. So just before we get going, I've got just a few housekeeping things to go through with you. So Wyndham, I might get you to move along to the next slide, please. Okay, so captioning is available today. So live captioning is available if anybody would like to avail of subtitles. You can do that by clicking on the CC button at the bottom of your screen. And just be aware, if you are using any screen reading software, it might interfere with that. So if you don't need the subtitles, please turn that off. If you've any questions, we're encouraging you to use the Q&A box. So again, that feature is at the bottom of the screen. That way we can kind of track the questions for our speaker, Sharon, today, and we'll have a Q&A session at the end of the main speech. And then you can chat with other attendees by using the chat box feature. So we encourage you to kind of say hello. I think Wyndham's already got things going in there. So if you want to let us know where you're dialing in from, and if you've any kind of comments on the session, we'd love to hear them as well. We are using the hashtag WAMinar today. So if you're engaging in social media, either throughout the session or later on, please use the hashtag WAMinar. And we will be sending the slides and the links to everybody after today's session. So we have over 300 attendees registered for today's event, so it's huge interest in this topic. So to get a sense of who's in the room, we're going to launch a short poll. So I'm going to get Wyndham to stop sharing the screen and launch the poll, and I'll read the questions out as well for anybody that may prefer to hear them. Okay, so please select the option most appropriate to you. I'm a hiring manager, I'm a line manager, I'm a regular employee, I'm a designated disability or access officer lead, I work in HR, or I don't meet any of the above. And the second question is to get a sense of what sector you work in. So further education, higher education, not-for-profit, private employer, or public sector. So while you're completing the poll, I just want to tell you a little bit about AHEAD and the WAM programme. So AHEAD works to create inclusive environments in both education and employment. AHEAD has been around since 1988. And the WAM programme, or WAM for short, was set up in 2005 and is funded by the Department of Social Protection. So the WAM program works with employers who ring fence graduate level placements or positions that are paid and mentored for a minimum of 6 months. And to date, we've placed over 620 graduates with disabilities in both the public and private sector. And about 80% of those graduates have secured full-time work as a direct result of that placement. So it's a hugely successful program, and we're extremely busy. We have, at the moment, lots of really great roles advertising. So we'd encourage you to have a look at our current opportunities page, where we're advertising with Maples Group, who are a legal firm, for a HR graduate. We've got our annual placements with the ESB, so we've 10 placements with the ESB, and we also have a role, a pharmaceutical role, with AbbVie up in Westport. So Cork, Dublin and Westport, we currently have roles in, so please share those across your networks. So I'm just going to go through the poll results now. Thanks, Wyndham. So if you want to share the results, so we have a variety of people in the room. We have regular employees at around 44%, line managers, 35%. We have line managers at 14%, disability access or disability liaison or access officers at 22%, HR 13%, and didn't meet any of the above. So we have a nice variety of people in the room. And also we have representation from further education, higher education, not-for-profit, public sector, and private employers. So public sector at 29, with the further and higher education, which is great to see representation from our head members here. That's brilliant. And then the private sector around 7%. So you can stop sharing, please, Wyndham. So today's topic is on dyspraxia, or developmental coordination disorder. In the WAM program, we've noted an increase of people with dyspraxia coming through our program and availing of placements. And we as a team are learning a lot more about dyspraxia, but we're also getting lots more questions from the employers around how to support or accommodate people with dyspraxia in the workplace. So we thought that this was a good topic to, I guess, get a promotion awareness around dyspraxia, but also get a better understanding of what it means to have dyspraxia and how you as an employer can, I suppose, support somebody or assist somebody in the workplace with dyspraxia. So today we're joined by Sharon Lane, who's the CEO from Dyspraxia, or DCD Ireland. So I'm going to ask Sharon to turn on her camera and join us this morning. Sharon's going to present on dyspraxia, and I suppose she's got a wealth of knowledge and understanding from her work in Dyspraxia DCD Ireland, along with her colleagues. So Sharon is the CEO, as I mentioned, and Dyspraxia DCD Ireland is a national organisation that supports people with dyspraxia and DCD. Sharon is also the founder of Working Well Ireland, a social enterprise that creates employment opportunities for people with mental health challenges. And for over 20 years, Sharon has worked across community, disability and mental health services in government and non-government roles, where she has developed extensive experience in managing and delivering innovative service models for people with mental health and disability needs. And Sharon is very passionate about breaking down barriers and making a difference for those who face disadvantage. So welcome, Sharon. We're very excited to have you here. And like I said, we have a huge interest in this topic. So welcome.
Thank you, Deirdre. Thank you so much. And I'm absolutely thrilled to be here this morning. And thank you to everyone who's zoomed in to be here with us today. Really appreciate it.
Okay, great. So we'll hand over while you're getting your slides up there. I'll just remind people that they can use the Q&A box to ask any questions, and we'll answer those towards the end. We'll leave about kind of 15 minutes at the end of the session. So over to yourself, Sharon.
Great, thank you. Can I just check that you can see my slides?
Yes, all good. And we can see you as well, which is great.
Perfect. Okay, so thank you for the lovely introduction. I am the CEO of Dyspraxia DCD Ireland, which sounds very impressive until I tell you that we're a very small organisation in terms of staffing, and we do a lot of work with very few resources. So we were established in 1995 as the Dyspraxia Association of Ireland, and we go by the name now of Dyspraxia DCD Ireland, and I'll explain that to you in a minute. We're the country's only national representative organisation, a voluntary organisation and a registered charity. We do support people across the country, but also people in Northern Ireland and people in the UK, and sometimes people, we've had people that we've supported from America and Canada as well. And we do all of this with 2.5 staff. So we're very dedicated, and we have an amazing group of volunteers and a very, very strong board of management as well. So we work with young people and adults. So there's no particular age cutoff point. Generally, children will be diagnosed or suspected of having dyspraxia around the ages of 5 to 6. We tend not to see children diagnosed any younger, and that's because of normal developmental delays with some children. They're just a little bit slower doing things than others. We work with families, and we work with health and educational professionals as well to deliver both clinical and support services. Information and advice, we have a helpline that runs, and we run education programs and training and counseling programs. So we also support other neurodiverse people who have a coexisting diagnosis of dyspraxia or DCD. And again, I'll explain a little bit more about that. And we advocate on behalf of our community, and we lobby government for improved diagnoses and service provisions across health and education. And that's the thing about dyspraxia. We work almost equally across across health and education. And that will become clearer as we go through. So our mission is a society where people with dyspraxia DCD have the self-knowledge, skills, and support to effectively navigate their world and fulfill their potential. It's where family members and service providers understand how best to provide support and help. And it's where professionals in the wider society, you and I, are equipped with information about dyspraxia DCD in order to promote understanding and accessibility at a national level. So what is dyspraxia DCD? It's a neurological condition that affects children and adults in the following areas: fine and gross motor skills. So fine motor skills, pencil writing, cutting with scissors, threading a needle, the very fine technique that we need to do those things, and gross motor skills, which are skills for everyday living, really. It could be walking up and down stairs, riding a bicycle, pouring a glass of milk. So that then affects coordination and balance in people. And sometimes it also affects speech, because when you think of it, the muscles that you have around your throat. So I'm talking now and the muscles are working in my throat. My tongue muscles are working. So we do all of this without realizing how many muscles are working. And with dyspraxia, sometimes those muscles can be quite impacted. The other side of dyspraxia then is around the executive planning skills and the executive functioning skills. So it could be organizational skills, planning your day. If you're at school, planning your classes, having your books ready, and sequencing, knowing what to do and in which order. It also can affect your auditory and verbal processing. So I might say something to you and you might hear it somewhat differently. And that, of course, then would have an effect on memory as well, because we're sort of, our memory can be a little overwhelmed, and it feels as if, you know, there's just no space in there to take in all of this information. So that, as you can imagine, can have quite an impact, particularly as children go into teenagers with all the demands of being a teenager, and into adulthood where they're trying to negotiate everyday life. It has an impact on social and emotional skills as well. So, bear with me. So just a quick run through of us. We're a national organization, as I said. We have over 500 members. We're a member-led organization. We're very proud of that. We started as a grassroots organization, or what we call a kitchen table organization. And our members have always been the backbone of our organization, as have our volunteers. We support over 2,000 families a year, and we do it through a range of different services and programs. One of the things we're very, very proud of is our POTS program. You see the little picture of the flower pots there. POT stands for Partnering in Occupational Therapy Telehealth Services. And we developed that with the University of Limerick during COVID, when schools were all closed down and service provision was closed, and our young people couldn't get any occupational therapy, physiotherapy and speech therapy services. And the University of Limerick couldn't access any placement positions for their students. So we developed a telehealth program, which we're very proud of and which we hope to expand outside of its current location in Limerick. We also identified a need to deliver, to develop, first of all, a program around best practice assessment and report writing. And that's very specifically aimed at occupational therapists and other clinicians who might be responsible for assessing dyspraxia, or DCD as it's formally called. And then we work with support groups across the country, and we run a range of different social activities, both online and in person during the year. So we know that at least one child and closer to two children in every classroom has dyspraxia. And that's a figure that, you know, I think some people are a little bit startled by, because dyspraxia isn't, or certainly hasn't in the past, been that well known. And overall, 6 to 10% of children in Ireland have dyspraxia, DCD. And it's on a continuum. So it's not something that you can say, okay, this child has dyspraxia, therefore, if this child is diagnosed, it's going to be the same. It's not. It's a continuum. So some children will have mild dyspraxia. Other children will have more severe dyspraxia. And then some of those children will also have other coexisting neurological conditions as well. And because very few people were diagnosed years ago, you know, it used to be called clumsy child syndrome before it was really understood what was going on. So there's a huge, huge number of adults out there in our population who have never been diagnosed, but would show very clear signs of being dyspraxic. And we estimate that around 8 to 10% of the overall population in Ireland are dyspraxic. And up to 50% of those people would have at least one other existing coexisting neurodiverse condition. And the most common are dyslexia, which often gets confused with dyspraxia, then attention deficit disorder, attention deficit hyperactive disorder, and autism spectrum disorder. They would be the main ones, but by no means the only ones. So again, this is just some of our services. We try to provide a wraparound service for families. So from point of coming to us with a query around diagnosis, to completing an assessment, diagnosis. We provide counseling services for parents and families and adults. We provide a range of different support networks. We educate professionals in the field. We support employment. That's really, really important for adults and young adults with dyspraxia. And we have a range of professional links with other services in the country for referral pathways. So let's get down to the nitty gritty. Why am I using these two phrases? What am I talking about when I say dyspraxia and DCD? So DCD, to start off with that, because it's the more straightforward one, is the clinical term used in the DSM-5, which is the, Diagnostic Services Manual for Mental Health Conditions. That may not be correct. I always forget it because I've used DSM-5 for so long. Anyway, it's a huge big book and it contains pretty much every neurological / mental health condition that there can be. And DCD is in that book. So it's a clinical term. It's a clinical diagnosis and it's called Developmental Coordination Disorder and it's shortened to DCD. And it refers to a condition in which an individual has severe difficulties in learning everyday motor skills, so they're the fine and the gross motor skills, which cannot be explained by physical, sensory, or intellectual impairment. And it's very important to point out that DCD, dyspraxia, is not an intellectual disability. Now, the term dyspraxia, however, is used in many different ways by different people, which can cause confusion. Some use it interchangeably with DCD, and I'm terribly guilty of that myself. I do it all the time, to mean pretty much the same thing. Others use it to refer to DCD plus difficulties with speech, organization, planning, sequencing, working memory, and the other psychological and emotional problems that I mentioned earlier on. Unlike DCD, there is no internationally agreed formal definition of the term dyspraxia, and it is not included in DSM-5. And many, many people refuse to drop the word dyspraxia because they feel that the condition as described in DSM-5 does not clearly outline all of the impacts. So I hope that sort of makes it clearer. But by all means, if you have questions on that, please do pop them in the chat box there. So, famous people with dyspraxia. I'm actually not going to give you the answer here. I'm going to get you to do this little piece of work here. So we've got some famous people with dyspraxia here, and let's see how many of them you can get. So I'll give you a few minutes just to start putting them in the chat box, if that's okay, Deirdre, and we'll see what people can come up with. Is that okay?
Definitely go for it.
Thank you. Just while you're doing that, I'll tell you a funny story. I went to a school a couple of months ago and I was giving a talk to the first, second and third year students. And of course I used these pictures. None of them had a clue who any of these people were. You know, they were like, who are they? And then I thought I should have just gone on TikTok and tried to find some influencers or somebody like that, because they didn't have a clue who any of these people, who I thought they would all get quite easily. No, wasn't happening. So yeah, Harry Potter, Daniel Radcliffe, yeah. Oh, wow, yes. Yeah, Holly Snell, well done. A lot of people don't get Holly. Yeah, Richard Branson, Robin Williams. Yeah, definitely. Who have we got? Who haven't we got? Okay, we're doing really well here. Robin, Flora, Cara, Daniel, Robin, Richard. Yeah, okay. We haven't got the guy in the top left-hand corner wearing a white England rugby jersey. And we haven't got, that I can see, Albert Einstein. Yeah, Daniel Radcliffe, Florence Einstein, yeah. I'm going to tell you about Einstein. Obviously, he was born way before there was such a thing as an official diagnosis of dyspraxia. But Einstein couldn't tie his shoelaces until he was 16, which is, you know, a lot of people with dyspraxia can't tie their shoelaces. And he had many, many other symptoms of dyspraxia and probably some other coexisting neurological conditions as well. So, yes. He's one. Okay, so nobody gets to go home early because nobody got every single one of them. So, but well done. That's great. That's really, really good. So in the top left-hand corner here, we have Ellis Gage. He's a rugby player. He plays for England, and he's a very, very strong advocate for dyspraxia. He does a lot of talks over in England for young people. And he's just a really good example of somebody who you would think, because, you know, dyspraxia impacting on fine and gross motor skills, well, how can he be a rugby player? But he can, because no two people with dyspraxia are the same. The guy in the check shirt down there is the photographer, David Bailey. And we find very often that people with dyspraxia will veer towards artistic subjects. They're very suited to a lot of those. So we have here singers, models, actors, writers, entrepreneurs, so you kind of get a flavor of the areas that people with dyspraxia can be drawn to. So well done, everyone. Thank you for that. Okay, so dyspraxia into adulthood. So as I mentioned, the condition isn't as widely known as conditions like dyslexia or autism. And even when you think about it, you know, going back 10, 15 years ago, autism, or ASD as we call it now, wasn't widely known either. And we used a phrase back in the day of children who were diagnosed with Asperger's. Now that phrase isn't used at all anymore. We've moved to autism spectrum disorder. And dyspraxia, somewhat like that, is more of a spectrum because it, as I said, it can be mild, it can be severe, but because of those other coexisting conditions, it can present in a number of different ways, and it can be quite hard to diagnose depending on the complexity involved. It's not something that you grow out of, and that was another myth about dyspraxia, that, you know, these kids were just clumsy and it's something that they're going to grow out of. It's not. It's a lifelong condition. It's a lifelong disorder, and it's a lifelong disability. So a person with dyspraxia who seems to be managing quite well has really learnt a lot of skills along the way to cope with the condition. And I've spoken to a number of adults. You know, I spoke to a gentleman who was 66 years of age and had never been diagnosed and finally got a diagnosis at 66. And he was just, you know, he was in tears because he'd believed all his life that he was the stupid or the clumsy one or the idiot, all those horrible negative words that he'd been called growing up, when in fact he had DCD. So there are very few studies involving adults with DCD. And again, it's because the space itself hasn't been researched very well. And those who are researching in the space tend to focus on the younger people, where the biggest bulk of the population is. The adults with DCD, again, are a little bit left out of that, but we are catching up and we are making inroads in that space. So we know that adults or students with DCD in further and higher education continue to report significant difficulties with handwriting and organizational skills. And thankfully, in this day and age, we are moving more and more towards the use of assistive technology, laptops, recording devices, smartphones, and these have a huge impact on the ability of people with DCD to be able to complete assignments, have enough time in exams, all of those things that are going to make a real difference in them achieving the careers that they want to in a number of areas. However, other difficulties can emerge, at least in part as a function of the changing environment as people age. So for example, while the increase in assistive technology is fantastic, learning to drive is still something that many young adults or older adults with DCD will find difficult to do. And we always recommend that they start off just getting confidence in maybe an automatic car where they don't have to perform so many different functions at the one time. But at the end of the day, people with dyspraxia have different needs, and there's a range of solutions that will be appropriate for different people. So I don't want you to think that what I'm saying is a blanket sort of rule for all people with dyspraxia. So given that it can be quite a complex condition, affecting gross and fine motor coordination, affecting balance, affecting tone, so the tone of your voice, affecting your sensory processing, there's a lot that a lot of impact that can have on a person. And particularly we see this in the areas of self-esteem and image and in opportunities for success. So self-esteem and image, obviously, you know, if people are telling you enough, or not even, they don't even have to tell you sometimes. Sometimes it's just your friends laughing at you because, oh, you're so clumsy, or, you know, somebody saying, oh, gosh, you can't be on our team because you just can't throw the ball, or, you know, we're going to lose if you're on our team. And saying it without really thinking about it, particularly if the person hasn't had a diagnosis, that can have a huge impact on self-esteem and lead to self and other exclusion. So self-exclusion, you know, having a headache or a migraine when sports lessons are on, not wanting to join in sports activities or, you know, team events, team sports. And that, again, can lead to social exclusion, anxiety and depression. So there's quite a lot that we have to be aware of in this space. So that's a lot of information that I've given you. Just to give you a little kind of an idea of what it might feel like for someone with dyspraxia, I'm going to ask you all, if you wouldn't mind, to stand up from your seat for this exercise. And I think your camera's already turned off anyway, so we won't be seeing you. But if you could stand up and just give a little stretch. And first of all, if you could stand on your right foot, and we'll count down the seconds. So standing on your right foot, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, not too difficult. Now, if you stand on your left foot only for 10 seconds, and again, we'll count down. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Not terribly difficult. Now, I want you to repeat the exercise with your eyes closed, and I'm not going to count. I'm just going to let you count in your head. So on your right foot with your eyes closed for 10 seconds, and then move to your left foot with your eyes closed for 10 seconds. Okay. Now, if you could tell me in the chat box, was there a difference when you closed your eyes and did that? And what was that difference? Some of you may not have had any difference, but I'm going to make a guess that a number of you would have felt a difference there. So let's have a look and see. Much harder, wobbly, quite wobbly with eyes closed. Yep, much harder. Yep, disorientated, felt dizzy, nearly fell over. Yep, easier to focus with your eyes open. Loss of balance. Yep. And that's exactly what I was expecting to hear you say. So if you can imagine that standing with your eyes open is what most of us would experience. Did I say standing with your eyes? Yes, I did. Standing on one foot with your eyes open is what we would mostly experience. For a person with dyspraxia, they would experience that wobbly sensation all of the time, not only when they're standing on one foot, it can be when they're standing on both feet. And again, I don't want to make a generalization, but that's just to give you an idea of what it might feel like for a person with dyspraxia. The same as if I asked you to take a pair of scissors in your non-dominant hand and cut out a star or cut out a circle, or to write your name with your non-dominant hand. That's what it feels like for a person with dyspraxia to write with either hand. That's how it feels all of the time. So I think that's a nice little exercise just to give you a feeling and a physical feeling of what it can be like for a person with dyspraxia. And in order for them to try and keep up with their peers, they have to work 10, 20, 50 times harder. So there's a lot of fatigue going on. We often talk to parents who say, oh, you know, Johnny's come home from school and all he wants to do is lie in the city. He won't join sports and he won't do this. He just wants to lie in the city all day. And we say to them, you know, that's fatigue. He's very fatigued because he spent all day in school trying to regulate, trying to keep up with everyone else. And now he's home in his safe place and he just wants to relax. And the same for behaviors, you know, kids with dyspraxia, like any kids really, can get very, very frustrated when they can't do the same things as their friends. They can't do it in the same amount of time. It takes them much longer. They've got to try much harder. This is going on all day in school. They come home and they might let loose. You know, they might be an absolute angel in school and a devil at home. And it's them just the frustration coming out. So again, there's a lot going on there for them. And that partly is why we provide a lot of different support services, both to the children and to their families. So let's move on to talking about dyspraxia and employment. Now you've got a feel for dyspraxia and how it sort of gradually can impact people over time. So many adults, as I said earlier, have developed their own strategies for working effectively. They are, I say often, but pretty much always, determined, persistent, hardworking, and highly motivated because they've had to be. They've learned this from a very, very young age. They don't want to be shown up. They don't want to be seen as less than. They don't want to be seen as the slow one or the clumsy one or the lazy one. So they are very motivated to keep up and to try very, very hard. They're very creative, or often very creative and original thinkers, as well as strategic problem solvers. Again, these skills have been built up since 5 years of age, if not younger. But however, some people with dyspraxia do find it hard to achieve their true potential and may need extra support at work. And I go back to this whole thing about, you know, the low self-esteem and the low confidence as well. That does have a huge impact. And particularly if a person has gradually over the years excluded themselves from a lot of different experiences and social activities. So people with dyspraxia may experience challenges when seeking employment and when in employment, including having the confidence to apply for jobs, using equipment such as staplers. These are just some very basic examples. Staplers, binders, medical tools, computer tools. You know, if you're a computer repair person, there's tiny, tiny little screwdrivers and screws and cogs and everything. Organizing workload in pressurized environments, communication, such as following oral instructions and taking part in class phone discussions. Handwriting, which we've mentioned again, that's a very classic one. Handwriting, riding bicycles, tying shoelaces are classic ones. And memory and concentration, particularly during times of stress, because the person will have been trying so, so hard to keep up with whatever's going on. But the strengths are, and these are, when I started with this organization, first of all, the one thing that I can tell you is that I was absolutely amazed by the similarity of strengths in people with dyspraxia. There's an amazing sense of optimism and integrity. And you don't see that in a lot of people, but it also, you know, it sounds strange even now saying it. And every time I said, it sounds strange that you can almost identify people in terms of optimism and integrity, but you can for people with dyspraxia. They're great problem solvers, outside the box thinkers, They're very persistent, creative, they're motivated, they're empathetic, and they're team players. And again, you might think, well, if this person is excluding themselves from a team, why would they be team players? They're team players because they know what it's like not to be included in teams. And they're empathetic because they know what it feels like not to be treated with kindness and, you know, and dignity. So these, you know, these strengths, I love putting this up because I stand by them, and the people that I know with dyspraxia, every single one of them have these strengths. So how can employers support staff with dyspraxia? Okay, so first of all, a person with any disability, not just dyspraxia, may be reluctant to disclose their condition, and disclosure may often only happen when trust has been developed between in that relationship between the employer and the employee. So an employer can make it easier by mentioning the accommodations they provide and the adjustments that they can provide to staff. So, and it's not something that you wouldn't be providing to other staff anyway in a lot of situations. So very, very often it might be using software such as an Outlook calendar. Some of us do it on a day-to-day basis. Other people don't do it, but it's a great little tool for people with dyspraxia and other neurological and other disabilities, in fact, to assist with organizational skills. I mean, I use it all the time and I color code mine all the time. I don't have a diagnosis of anything, but I couldn't be without my Outlook calendar just to help me keep everything on track. And trusting and giving responsibility is very important, as people with dyspraxia haven't often had that opportunity. Not all of them, but some of them haven't had that opportunity. They make great coaches, team leaders, project managers, customer service and helpline staff, really good frontline staff, because again, they engage with people very well in general. Again, I'm generalizing, but in general. And they make great computer and IT people. And it's not that whole, you know, oh, the IT geeks. It's actually that they're really interested in the workings of these things and how they happen and what, you know, what the outcome is going to be. So there's lots there in terms of, you know, people with dyspraxia, what works for them and how you can support them. And here's a question that we don't often cover. What supports are available for employers? So employers, obviously we have, you know, we're here today talking about WAM, which is a great support, but we have other supports that, you know, very practical everyday supports that employers may not know about. Dyspraxia DCD Ireland provide a range of supports. We provide supports both to adults in terms of our counselling service. We have would have a number of adults with dyspraxia engaging with our counselling service because they're worried about retaining their employment or they're feeling stressed at work. And our counsellors would work through disclosure with them and how they might have that conversation with their employer about, you know, maybe making some workplace adjustments. Specialist Stern is an organization that works with neurodiverse people to support them into employment. And the Open Doors Initiative, again, working with some very marginalized groups there. I think we have some people here today from Employability, an absolutely great organizations, and National Learning Network, again, helping people. So there's a lot of help out there who can help both the person with the disability and the employer. And then there's financial incentives, the wage subsidy scheme and the employee retention grant. And we can provide you with some more information on those if you're interested, if you want to find out more about that. So I know I'm running out of time here. I think we want to have some time for questions, and I hope you have lots of questions for me because I love talking, as you probably figured out. But what I'd like to just say now is a huge thank you to everyone on behalf of our organization, our members, the people that we work with, and to give you some links there. While you're having a look at those links, I'll just tell you a very quick little story about a lady who contacted us, an employer who contacted us. She runs a very small boutique and she has one employee, and that employee has dyspraxia. And she contacted us for information. She'd gone to our website and then she'd emailed us and we'd pointed her to our videos and we talked to her about different things and sent her lots and lots of information. And she came back a little while later and she said, you know, I'm so delighted with that help that you gave me that I'd like to run a fashion show for you. So she ran a fashion show fundraiser for us, and it was amazing. It was such a lovely evening. And one of the people at the fashion show was a jewelry designer, a lady who's a jewelry designer. And she had actually gone out of her way to make jewelry to go with all of the outfits that were in the fashion show. And that was a lot of jewelry. And she just did it, you know, because she's just a really good person. Obviously, she was selling her jewelry as well, but it was a lot of work that she put into it. So a little while later, we were looking at developing some sort of a badge, you know, a little emblem for people with dyspraxia. And we contacted this lady. So now we have a partnership between us where she's going to design our badges for us. So out of just tiny little things, you know, and I could give you 10 more stories like that, but out of tiny little things, people contacting us, us providing information, supports, lots and lots of different relationships and partnerships grow. So please don't be afraid to contact us at any time. So thank you so much.
Thanks a million, Sharon. That's been really, really informative. And I think the practical exercises, I know a couple of people couldn't engage in them, so sorry about that. But I suppose it gave people that real sense of what it can be like to have dyspraxia and just that insight from childhood right up to adulthood. So I suppose we do have some questions, and I probably have a few coming from the kind of WAM context, but we might start with what's in the Q&A, if that's okay. So near the start of your presentation, you talked about some statistics. We have a question around where did those numbers come from? So for example, the one or two per classroom having dyspraxia or DCD, and also do you find it goes undiagnosed until the higher level classes in primary school?
So I'm just going to write something down there, which is a reminder to myself to put the links to the statistics up onto the slideshow for future reference.
And we can share them afterwards as well.
Perfect. Yes. So what I'll do is I'll send you the links for that. Most of the links, and as I mentioned, most of our statistics would come from research that's been carried out in the UK, and Australia are quite good on research as well. But what we've found that across all of the countries that we would engage with, that we would talk to, that the statistics are very, very similar. So it's not that one country would have a higher, you know, it's not like England would have 15% and Australia would have 5%. All countries in, you know, America and Canada, they're coming across very, very similar. So while we only have limited research ourselves, we do tend to pull from other countries too.
Right. And somebody did ask as well, is there a genetic kind of base to dyspraxia? Do you know?
There's no formal genetic link, although it has been said that it can be, there could be a genetic link, but it's a could be. So I wouldn't say that that's a definite, but we do find very often that we would have families where a parent might have dyspraxia and one or two of the children might be diagnosed with dyspraxia as well.
Okay, great, brilliant. There is a question there around, and you may or may not be able to answer this. What do you think about the word disorder and how this is so widely used to describe diversity? You're smiling. You like that question.
I do like that question because I think the language we use is so important. And the, you know, some of this medicalized language is just, it's quite annoying. Your disorder and even, you know, disability. I don't have a diagnosed disability, so I'm not qualified to say what a person with a disability prefers to use or to have used, you know. And I've worked with so many people over the years, and they will, one person will say, I want to be called dyspraxic. And the other will say, oh my gosh, no, don't call me that. So, but the word disorder, it's any word or any phrase that has a negative connotation, I believe shouldn't be used. You know, we shouldn't be using that. Yeah. Neurodiversity itself, I think, is also becoming a little bit of a label as opposed to being really well understood, but that's a whole conversation for
It's interesting because we are thinking about doing a WAMinar on that, and that neurodiversity or neurodivergent and neurotypical and all of that. And I suppose what we in a head would say as well, the language is really interchangeable. So some people use, you know, I'm a person with a disability, or they use the disability term. So, and disorder, we would see a lot of disorder being used maybe for kind of medical conditions, so things like ongoing illnesses and things like that, as opposed to more of your usual disabilities. Okay, so the next question is, so like I said, we've a high number of people attending from higher and further education, which is great. So do you consider it sufficient for students in state exams with DCD who are not using technology to just be given rest breaks as opposed to be given extra time? So, and also, so I'll ask that bit, and then there's the second part of the question, Sharon.
So whoever asked that question, thank you so much for asking that question, because that is such a bugbear of mine. And you and I could have a conversation about this, I'm sure, over a cup of coffee for at least 2 hours. We are working so hard and have done, and I mentioned it, we work across disability and education. The education component of it is 90% of the work that we do is advocating for reasonable accommodations in state exams. So a child in primary school may or may not receive a laptop, and then they have to be reassessed in secondary school, and then the trouble starts. Secondary school is a minefield, and it's because of the state exams and the rigidity, if that's even a word, around the criteria, you know, the criteria for getting accommodations in exams. When you get onto third level, it's actually much, much easier again. And In second level education, we are fighting constantly. We've had TDs making parliamentary questions on, putting forward parliamentary questions on our behalf. We've met with the SEC, we've met with the Department of Education. It's an archaic system. That's all I can tell you. It's an absolutely archaic system. So the answer is absolutely not to give someone a movement break or a rest break and not additional time, or to offer them a scribe when that person is going to have to spend, you know, somebody who's in an exam setting, they're stressed already, they have to use their executive functioning skills to describe what they want the scribe to write on their behalf. It's madness, it's absolute madness. And when we look at the figures of young people with disabilities getting into third level education and bemoaning the fact that so few are getting into third level education, although it is improving, it doesn't make sense to keep putting these barriers in place and to say, oh, well, we can't give a person with a disability an unfair advantage. Really? Is that the mindset that we should be having? I don't think so. Sorry, got a little bit carried away.
No, that's great to hear. And I suppose there's a kind of, it leads on to, you know, what about practical assessments? So for example, in PE, home economics, woodwork, where you were talking about those kind of fine motor skills where you might need those or be reliant on them. And what about those practical assessments? What do you think about that? What can be put in place for students?
Again, some students vary. Now, I've spoken to students who would say things like, you know, I love woodwork. I'm great. And they're great. They're genuinely great at woodwork. But they may be, you know, they may struggle with a language, and vice versa. You may have a student who is great at languages and struggles with tech drawing or something like that. So what would happen in those situations is that a scribe, if it's a technical examination, a scribe would sometimes be provided or offered to that person. Again, we really felt during COVID that this is the ideal time to review the whole criteria, how we deliver education, the whole pedagogy around education for young people. We had so many young people who were at home and doing their classes, and my own children as well. I have two children with additional needs, and who were at home on the laptops, and who were so, you know, they were so relieved. They weren't in these high-pressured environments with lots of noise and activity going on around them, and they could just focus on the class at hand. And then COVID ended and we went back to exactly the same situation again, and it was so disappointing. So there absolutely needs to be a huge national campaign around this. I know Dyspraxia Ireland currently have a campaign going that we're supporting in relation to additional time. We have had some success in getting students Irish exemptions in state exams, but there's a huge amount of work to still do.
And I suppose coming from an employment perspective, what do people with dyspraxia need both at recruitment but and in the workplace? So you mentioned that a lot of people don't actually apply for jobs. So how can employers be encouraging people with dyspraxia to, number one, apply, get through the recruitment process, and then have a successful employment?
Okay, I would say, first of all, that the employer needs to have a really clear understanding themselves before they even start any recruitment process, before they draw up any job description. They need to have a really clear understanding of why they feel it's important to know which applicants might have a disability and what, you know, why they're looking for that information, and then what they would do with that information. Mm-hmm. So we would hope that most employers would be looking for that information based on a strategy that they have within their organization to increase the number of employees with a disability to create a more diverse and accessible workplace.
Yeah.
That would be the standard reason. But, you know, sometimes we have that in our head, but we don't actually have it written down anywhere. We don't have a policy around it. It's just an idea. And then you're hit with reality of like, how am I going to make this work? So they're the steps that you actually need to go through first before anything else happens. And as an employer, it can be a really significant challenge to create an inclusive and supportive environment for people with disabilities. So, you know, then moving on to that question of, okay, now how would I make it easier for a potential employee to disclose to me that they have a disability, and understanding that some people might want to disclose at the beginning, some people might want to develop that trust-based relationship, others might prefer to have an intermediary, such as the WAM liaison officer, to be present with them. And I know WAM does a lot of work, as do other organizations who are present here today, do a lot of work in talking through disclosure with their clients and talking about the potential benefits, of which there are far more than negatives of making that disclosure. And that's why you have such a high disclosure rate, which is fantastic. And I've worked with other programs where they do exactly the same thing. And once you can have that conversation with a person around disclosure and make it and normalize that conversation, it makes it a lot easier for them to go into an interview and then make the, you know, make those statements. So I think for employers, you know, give the applicants, or just realize that the applicant needs to be able to choose when they disclose and how they disclose, but you provide ways of enabling that for them. And also to, you know, be very, so that's in the application process. So there's a couple of stages. Sorry, I'm going on a little bit long here.
Yeah, no, you're really quick. Fine.
So you have the job application, you know, write it in plain English, make sure you say in the application that we welcome applications from people with whatever it might be, disabilities or a different language, find the language that you want, but make sure it's a respectful language, not a stigmatizing or a medicalized language. And so you're not saying, you can say rather than, do you have a disability on a form as a tick box exercise, you can ask an applicant, do you require any adjustments or supports? So change the language and how you use the language. And
your point about what's actually done with that information, it's really, we would be kind of reiterating that a lot in the WAM program. You know, when you're asking, do you have a disability, it's because we can help accommodate, or this is what's done with the information. If you're successful for the role, you know, what can be put in place, that kind of thing. So it's not just to kind of know if you have a disability, there's an actual purpose to asking the question.
Absolutely. And then being clear about what you're going to do with that information once you get it as well, because that can be a cause of angst for some people. And I think there was recently a workplace settlement for an employee who had disclosed only to her manager, and that manager had shared the information without permission to other people in the workplace. So that resulted in a very messy situation for people. So you need to be very clear to your and understand yourself what you're going to do with that information, how it's going to be best used, and who the employee has given you permission to share it with. So that's a big, big one, I think, that employers need to think through as well. And then for an interview, I would say, you know, create a really positive and welcoming environment during the interview, and make sure that, you know, the practical side of things, that the location is accessible. If someone is a wheelchair user, that, you know, they can get into the building, they can get to the meeting room with the least need to ask for help as possible. Provide any other adjustments that people might need. Yourself, Deirdre, language interpreters, assistive devices, additional time. Wyndham Head have lots of fantastic resources there that you can have a look at. And for applicants, with dyspraxia in particular, I would say, you know, as an employer, do your homework, find out what dyspraxia is, or at least get a basic understanding of what it is before the person walks into the room, because it'll help both you and the candidate put you both at ease and make the interview process a lot easier. If you have a staff member who has dyspraxia, you'll consider asking them if it's appropriate, could they sit on the interview panel, or could they give you some tips about, you know, how might we make this this process easier? Very important to ensure that you give the candidates enough time to process the questions and formulate an answer. So don't rush them through the questions, otherwise you're going to miss some really good answers. And if the candidate says, you know, I'm sorry, I don't understand that question, try to rephrase it rather than ask exactly the same question again. Ask the question in a slightly different way. And then obviously, if the interview process requires written exams, or you know, please do give them the opportunity to use assistive technology to do that.
Yeah, the online version, great, that's brilliant. And I suppose that even the application form, if there is one, that can be filled out electronically if people prefer to handwriting something as well. Yeah. Okay, brilliant. I think there's one question here that I might just ask you, and we'll probably wrap up then. So have you come across misdiagnosis with hypermobility? I've had many students before who were sent for dyspraxia assessment because of issues with handwriting to be allowed exam and arrangements, etc., but it turned out it was not dyspraxia at all, but they had hypermobility. And actually somebody asked as well, how do you get a diagnosis? So you might start by saying, where does somebody go for a diagnosis? You talked about children, but also people maybe that weren't diagnosed as a child, what can they do next? But also that piece around the hypermobility, please, Sharon.
No problem. So I might just mention the hypermobility first. And yes, that has certainly happened a lot in the past. What we would always recommend, and I'm, you know, Stephen, our OT, would answer this in a far more refined way than I will. I'll give you the layman's terms. What we would recommend, if normally, I'll just talk about our own service. So if somebody were to contact our occupational therapist, Stephen, he would have a conversation with the parent, and he might then have a follow-up conversation with the teacher or the other person who might have suggested to get an assessment for dyspraxia. If he's not sure about it, he might suggest that they undertake a handwriting assessment first. And that's where you would find more around the hypermobility, you know, rather than going into the full dyspraxia assessment, because people can sometimes see the handwriting. And as I said, it is one of the initial indicators, but of dyspraxia, but it's not only dyspraxia that it's an indicator of. So that's how we personally in our organization would go around that one. And then in terms of getting an assessment, so for a child, and there's lots of information on our website as well. So for a child, the first thing we always recommend, whether you're going through the public system or the private system, is that you do register with the public health team in your local area. And there's long, as everyone knows, huge waiting lists there, ranging at the moment from between 18 months and 4 years for most people. So a lot of people are now choosing to go privately, and unfortunately there's long waiting lists in the private sector now as well, plus the cost is a barrier to a lot of people. But always register with the public health system, then find you can have an occupational therapist, a neurologist, a psychologist, and a pediatrician. They would be the main people who would diagnose for children. For adults, it's a lot more difficult, because there is no public adult diagnostic pathway in the country. We're developing that. I'm very proud to say that we're actually developing a really best practice adult diagnostic assessment pathway. But that will be another few months down the track, but there's nothing available in the public health system. And people who go privately, I think we've only got about 4 or 5 occupational therapists that I know of in the country who are diagnosing at present for adults. So it's a lot more difficult, but please do get in touch with us if you have any queries.
That's great. There are two very short questions. I might quickly answer one of them and you can add to it then, Sharon. So somebody's asking around for people with dyspraxia managing kind of busy schedules, multiple deadlines, and the anxiety of upcoming exams. But I actually think this relates to what the workplace can be like as well. So any tips or recommended tools or techniques for how to support students with DCD organizing their schedules? So I might let people know about the AHEAD AT Hive that you can actually go on on and look at the various assistive technologies available. And also you can answer by question. So it might be, I need assistance with organizing, and it'll give you some recommendations of tools that you can use. So that's a really good resource on the AHEAD webpage, and Wyndham might drop in the AT. Oh, she's actually popped it in the chat box. Yes. But Sharon, from your perspective, are there kind of particular tools or assistive technology that people with dyspraxia do use? Not to generalize, but are there some of the same ones that are coming up for you?
Laptops would definitely be the biggest one. So we would have children using laptops from quite a young age and right through the school system. When you think about, you know, to get accommodations in exams, you have to be able to, or you have to be able to, you have to have a writing speed of less than 10 words a minute. And even at that, you get very limited additional time. It doesn't cover the words that you've missed. So the use of a laptop can be a total game changer for somebody in the school setting. We, you know, most schools ban the use of phones for students, but we would also always encourage the student or the student's parents to have a chat with their teacher just to see if they could, obviously with very strict boundaries, use their phone to take photographs of the board if there's writing on the board, or, you know, in different situations to maybe use voice recorders. Obviously there's huge implications around that, but some schools have allowed that for students. It's so different for each person, so I don't want to really go too far into it, but again, you know, we have some resources, and we've got a lovely transition to school program as well, transitioning from primary school to secondary school, and the different supports that you can put in. But what I would say to people is that you need to start early. You need to start while the children are in primary school, so you can actually start preparing them for secondary school. It's no point in getting a child assessed in a laptop in junior cert year when you want them to use the laptop for their junior cert. You know, it's way too much pressure on them. So start early, get your information and look at all the different, there's so much technology, assistive technology out there now. It's amazing. It's probably a little bit overwhelming, but if in doubt, you know, do contact us.
Yeah, no, that's brilliant. And we're seeing that technology, in particular with the move to remote working, has enabled a lot more people with disabilities to fully engage in the workplace. And I suppose both work from home, but also avail of kind of, I suppose, the assistive technology that's growing and developing and much more available. And even things like Office 365, we're seeing the features in that are amazing for people with disabilities, and they're readily available in the workplace. Yes.
And I see a number of the attendees have put in some really great comments there in terms of what we can use. I'm going to take some of those comments.
I know, it's great, isn't it? And I think that kind of, to finalize on that, that the person with dyspraxia themselves will know themselves best, and you can see even the ideas coming through there from people that either have experience or know somebody maybe with dyspraxia. So it's asking the person what they need in the workplace and as best as you can accommodating that. Okay. Sharon, thank you so much. That's been amazing, and lots of great questions at the end as well. Sometimes that's where the conversation can start going off in tangents here and there. So hopefully people got some good ideas towards the end around that kind of inclusive workplace, but also understanding people with dyspraxia. So thank you so much, and we'll send the recording to you after, if you want to kind of pop it on your webpage to have it available for other employers to watch through your own webpage. So thank you so much.
Thank you everyone else for turning up today. Really appreciate it.
That's brilliant. So I'd like to thank the audience for attending, and I am to give a big shout out to Wyndham, my colleague who I didn't introduce at the start. Sorry, Wyndham. Wyndham's been busy on tech support, and she'll be emailing the slides and the links to everybody after the session. And I suppose we are always open to your feedback. So we will be sharing a link to get some feedback on today's session. And if you have any ideas for upcoming webinars, we'll be running one probably September, October time, so we're really keen to hear what people might want to see at the next webinar, so keep an eye on the web page for that invite going out soon. So thanks a million everyone, and we'll see you next time.